terms of India, the crops that are native to the region, and I'm interested in working out the wild gene pools of the crop plants, the wild species that we can use for improving our crop plants. And citrus is a very, very unique crop in which it's very easy to make hybrids.
Okay.
Operating whether it is disease resistance, whether it is drought resistance or frost resistance, the potential of wild species and cultivated species is very high. So that's okay. The reason I found citrus very unique and something which I had to spend a lot of time to be able to sort out the problems that I have in the group.
Right.
Okay. That is one major reason why I have been focusing on this.
Okay. So we have here Shamik also. Shamik, shall we start? Are we good to go? Okay. So you have a presentation. Do you want to cast your screen?
Yeah.
Yeah. So can we do that now?
Yeah, let's do that. How do I get rid of myself from the window?
Let me cast the presentation.
Okay.
You have to share. Sorry.
What I can do is I can remove it and redo it.
Yeah, we can try. Okay, I have cast my screen.
Shall I start now?
Can everyone see the presentation?
Yes, we can see it.
Okay. So I think we can start.
As I said just now, I did have a dilemma as to what I should cover because this topic of citrus is really vast. Can we move to the next slide?
Yeah.
So I decided to start off directly with the species and go on to the oldest known species of citrus. This is the citron, which we call in botanical terms, citrus medica. In Hindi, it is called bada nimbu. As you can imagine, bada, so it is definitely bada. The important thing is that it is native to the eastern Himalayas. But since citrus is by and large a crop of the tropics and subtropics, you find it in the valleys of the foothills. It's a specific region, a niche that you find it in. The fruits are big, it has a rough surface, it is dry, but the rind is thick. And therefore, the rind is used for as preserves, to candy it, etc. An important thing about this species is it's self-pollinated. And it is monoembryonic, meaning it sets true seeds. After fertilization, you have the true seeds forming. And a very important thing about it is that it bears flowers and fruits throughout the year. Why do we call it the oldest one? It is native to the Indian region, but when Theophrastus, he's referred to as the father of botany, he called it a Persian apple, meaning this plant was already known in the Persian region. It had already reached the Persian region. More important, it is part of the traditional Jewish harvest festival. It has been depicted on the walls of the Egyptian temple, which is over 3,500 years old. This is the importance of the citron, that is citrus medica. Now I'm going to go to the next slide. This is a very interesting plant. If you go to the Chinese markets or you go to Singapore or any of those places where you have the Chinese plants, This will be available in the market. It is called Buddha's Hand, and it is generally available during the Chinese New Year. It is generally available as a fist, or it can be where the fingers have not joined up. It literally looks like a finger. So that's the reason why it is called Buddha's Hand, and it is a variety of citron. In all other ways, it is exactly like the same citron. We can use it for making marmalades. You can use the rind and you can preserve it. There is no problem, except that the different parts of it, of the fruit, have not joined up, and therefore it has this peculiar appearance. Next slide. There is one more point that I need to highlight about citron. If you look at the bar diagram that is there on top, and look at those four scales, four yellow lines, it shows that citron is a pure species. Look at all the other material that is there on that bar line. When you look at the limes and the lemons, it has a small amount of the blood of citron in it. Look at that flowchart which is below. Citron is important as the main parent, as a pollen source for the lemons. Other species which are available in the northeastern region, one of them is the Rangpur lime. There's another one called the rough lemon. It is the pollen source for all these materials that have developed in the northeastern region. Citron is one of the three basic species of citrus. Which are the other two? One is the pomelo. Look at the pomelo in that bar diagram. It's green. But that same green is repeated in the oranges, grapefruits, and some of the types of the mandarins also. Now look at the third type, which is the mandarins. This is the third pure species. And there you find that there is so much of crossing all over. It has been used as the male parent, where you have that circle with that arrow, that is male. And where you have a circle with that plus below, that is a female. You will find that mandarins have mostly crossed with pomelos, and you have got quite a lot of the oranges, oranges and the sweet lime, the bitter lime, all of them have arisen from these hybridizations. And that is the reason in the bar diagram also, you see there's a combination of that green color and the orange color, that is the mandarin and the pomelo. Next slide. I would like to talk a little bit about the pomelo. This is the second basic species that we talked about. Unlike citron, which is native to the Indian region, the Eastern Himalayan region, this is native of the Southeast Asian region, below Indo-Burmese region, that is Indonesian, Indo-Chinese region. It has, though citron is called Bara Nimbu, the largest fruits and citrus you have in pomelo. There is one, again, like citron, it is monoembryonic, meaning it produces the true seeds. But there's one point which I would like to highlight in this context. When a citrus species, whether it is a basic one or a hybrid, when it moves from one region to the other, what happens? From Southeast Asia, it moved to the Chinese region. So what happened? We have this wild species, Tachibana, in South China. Alongside that, you have the two cultivated types, the white-fleshed sweet types and the pink-fleshed sour types. Just that movement from Southeast Asia to South China has brought in so much of variation. Next slide. After this, since I've already said mandarin has given its blood to quite a lot of commonly known citrus, I'm just straight away going on to some of the examples of the well-known cultivated citrus fruits. One of them is grapefruit. Earlier, we only knew it in the novels and the books. It was written in New Zealand, Australia. It was a breakfast food. It used to be prepared by slicing. Sugar used to be put in, and the flesh could be scooped out with a spoon and eaten. But actually, it's a very interesting thing that it's an accidental cross which took place in the Caribbean islands between a pomelo, which had been taken out from Indonesia during the East India Company time by a Captain Shaddock, which crossed with a Jamaican sweet orange, which was growing alongside it. It was an accidental cross. It was documented in 1750, but think of it, it was given a name after the 1940s called Paradisiae species, but it was sent to Florida and that's where it was commercially cultivated and grapefruit became an important fruit. And it was in that grove developed by Atwood in which that variant, the pink colored grapefruit, also developed. Next one. Here we come to another example, quinoa, a very successful fruit. But it has a shorter time between the development and it is acceptance. It was again between the pomelo and the mandarin, but the amount of blood that has come in from the different species is definitely more complicated in this. And what has happened is it was developed at the Field Gene Bank in a place called Riverside, California. It's one of the biggest field gene banks with maximum representation of citrus from all over the world. It was deliberately, experimentally developed there in 1935. By 1954, it had been introduced into India and Pakistan and did very well. That first quinoa was full of seeds, but Pakistan, India, and even in California, Riverside, all three places, they were successful in developing the low-seeded ones later on, which have, to a large extent, overtaken that old 1954 introduction. Next one. This is just a quick look at the summing up look at it. In this map, citrons in the Indian region, Chinese region, you have the mandarins, you have the pomelos in the Indonesian Indo-Chinese region. There are also some of the related genera of citrus. Micrantha, this is called a papeda. And you have something called kumquat. Earlier, it used to be a genus called Fortunella. Now it has been included in the citrus. The important thing is what we used to call a species of citrus, what used to be species of papeda and the kumquat, they are all crossable. So you can imagine the amount of scope potential for hybridization, accidental, spontaneous, or otherwise, because everything crosses very easily. The next thing is this bar diagram, not a bar diagram, but it's supposed to be, it is showing the relationships. You find that the citrons, mandarins, and pomelos are the older ones as compared to the Australian limes, which have become quite important now, and they are in the process, like the kiwi fruit. The Australian limes are at the moment being domesticated and brought out into the market, and they are becoming very popular. I've just put a photo at the end here. This is, you can see, a very thorny plant with leaves which are very different from what you see in citrus. This is a very distinct thing which used to be part of citrus. It's the Poncerus. It is ancient to the citrons, the mandarins, and the pomelos too. Next one. Now, there are some other aspects of these successful materials that I would like to indicate. One of them is the Nagpur orange, or it is actually the Nagpur mandarin. These photographs have been taken, have been documented in the Riverside, from the Riverside, California collection. And the important thing is that this is a material which was taken from the eastern and northeastern plains by the rulers of Vidarbha. That is, generally the Bhosles have been credited with that, with realizing the potential and bringing it into the Vidarbha region, and it's become successful. The documentation that has been made by Riverside very clearly indicates a thing called the resting treatment, which indicates why it is so successful in the Vidarbha region. In that region, for that matter, not only the local climate and the soil, But the typical climate in India, very hot summer and a sudden onset of the monsoon, leads to profuse flowering and therefore simultaneous fruiting. And that has been, it's considered so important in citrus, it was documented in the 1960s document from Riverside. The important thing is that it has got a geographic indicator tag, which helps the cultivators of this to get a good value for the product when they are either distributing it within the country or exporting it to. Another one. Next one slide, Trish. Okay. Now two slides, I'm just putting the whole thing into a perspective. Just look at that pie chart. Small number of species accepted, large number of names which are duplicated, and the others are those names which are not at all acceptable. There's some mistake in them. 494 species names have been documented for citrus. Can imagine the amount of confusion. Flora of Pakistan lists 100 species, but now we have brought it down to 20 to 25 species all over the world in citrus, though we have such a large number of crops. Next slide. There are very few crops which find a mention in a popular magazine like National Geographic. Citrus is one of these. Other than this, I'm only aware of cucurbits, which have been given such a good coverage. And it is indicating what has been given in the scientific paper has been developed into something which is understandable by the common man. It has been developed in collaboration with Riverside, California to bring out this chart. Next slide. Now we come to one aspect which is important, which is knowing where our diversity is and trying to ensure that that diversity is available for use. In the 1980s, there was this effort made to document what is that diversity which we know is available in the Northeastern region. And it was brought out in the form of a book. Now, this Nokrek National Park, which is part of the one of the two large mountain ranges of Meghalaya, the Tura Range, is a UNESCO designated biosphere reserve. What is even more unique is any biosphere reserve, any protected area, you find that mention is there only of the animals or the birds. But the important thing about the Nokrek National Park is it is the home of the wild Indian orange, the most primitive among all wild species of citrus. Next slide. That dried specimen that you can see on the left-hand side is a specimen which was put into a herbarium in 1850. It was the basis of the collection that was described in the Flora of British India. The one on the right-hand side is one which has been collected almost 100 years later. No difference in the morphology. My colleagues at the NBPJ, Dr. Malik, etc., had made the collection in the late 1990s and early 2000, and they collected this citrus indica. Ceremonies in Meghalaya and some of the neighboring states. But when they went again...
We are not able to hear you.
Oh.
Yeah, now it's fine.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
So when they went for collection in 2005, they found a larger type, which was called Mameng Arctic, I think. And this was ultimately found to be an intermediate one, a hybrid between the wild indica and what we call the citron. Meaning within a short period, you had hybridization occurring of the cultivated or the naturalized population of citron with the wild species. Next one. Next slide, Prash. This is just a thing which has been said. Dr. Harlan is one of the foremost among the plant genetic resources workers who talked about the importance of the centers of diversity and how we are losing the diversity centers because of the movement of the germplasm. And we have to conserve it if we have to ensure that the original material is stored. This is very important as far as citrus is concerned, as we saw from the citrus indica example. Next slide. So now I'm coming to conservation. It can be in situ, as was done in the citrus gene sanctuary, or now the Nockrek biosphere reserve. Now in situ has become the latest the fashionable topic for all crops all over the world. Everybody's talking about in situ. So that's the only way we can preserve our land races and our wild species diversity. But the more important thing is the ex situ collections, like in Riverside, of course. But more important and unique to citrus is how to conserve it for a long term at low temperatures. In gene banks, when you're storing seeds or embryos, you need to reduce the moisture. If you don't reduce the moisture, what will happen is that the water will freeze and it will cause freezing injury. What was unique about citrus was that it, unlike field crops like rice, wheat, or industrial crops like cotton, when you dry it to the same temperatures, low moisture levels, they would die. They don't have as high moisture as tropical fruits like jackfruit or mango. Therefore, the seeds are of an intermediate type between the field crops and the true tropical crops. That is one unique thing which we discovered about citrus, which affects their conservation. As per that statement made by Dr. Harlan, we can lose the diversity because of loss of habitat, of loss of material. But there is a more important point. As in banana, in citrus also, you have a very devastating disease. It's called the citrus greening disease. It's a literal translation from Chinese is yellow dragon disease. It's caused by a bacterium, there are two vectors, an Asian one and an African one. An insect which causes its transmission. And so far, three forms of this disease have been discovered. There's a heat-tolerant Asian form and a heat-sensitive African and American form. And it is spreading rapidly. It was described in 29, first reported in China in 43. By 48, it was in Africa. By 2005, Florida collections had been affected. By 2009, 33 countries have reported that it's available. I saw one small little report saying that almost every continent in the world now has it. So it is a major disease, which is likely to affect citrus, and everybody is being very cautious about it. Next slide. When I started, I just wanted to look at what are the points which I wanted to bring out. That is a major crop. I've been able to bring it out. Why is it, besides being a number three crop, it is available over a wide range of habitats. You have these groves where it is cultivated for commercial utilization. Every backyard, you can say, would be having one, whether it is a lemon or an orange or whatever it may be, but you would be having. It is gathered from the wild as in the northeastern region. And you find that it is being sold in the local huts. That is a place where you can see the new types that are being brought in. Next important point for citrus from the Indian point of view, Indian region is in the heart of the citrus diversity area. So the Indian region, the Indo-Chinese, Sino-Japanese, and the Indo-Chinese regions are important. Indo-Indonesian regions are important. But when you look at the spread of the crop, and the different types you are having, you can practically say that most of the world has it, has its local adapted types available. If not, the utilization of it, as for example, that from the Chinese and the Japanese, now it's become part of the Christmas tradition in the UK and USA. So citrus has become a major part of the on a global scale. And the third point I have already indicated, the unique type of adaptation that monoembryony and most of the hybrids that you're having are polyembryonic, meaning that the embryos that are formed are multiple, and most of them are formed from the maternal tissue. So they are not the true hybrid embryos that are coming up. So the male and the female parents are not reflected in those embryos which are getting out. And last of all, conserving is very more distinct as compared to any of the other crops. And now we have been able to get geographic indicator, and two examples I gave of the Nagpur orange and Citrus indica, that is the wild Indian orange. But besides that, Jalna orange, there are several others, at least three or four more, in which we have got the GI tags already given. Next one. These tags, now that they have been given, they are trying to get the farmers who are cultivating those specific crops to apply for it, register for it, which will be valid for 10 years. And government pay is part of the funding for it. The rest of it, the cultivator himself does. Now I'm just summing up the actual contributions that have been made. The floristic study was done in the 1980s by the Botanical Survey of India. Dr. K.N. Nair and M.P. Nair were responsible for it. This Indian wild citrus is the next most important point in citrus. It was collected in, as I said, 1850, but it was detected and described by Tanaka only in 1928. The next one becomes that gene sanctuary. The unique thing is that we were doing a checklist of the crop plants of India, which was the basis for the wild relatives of crop plants in India. This is the one genus among all with the maximum number of cultivated species. Getting the identity right was the biggest and most time-consuming and most difficult thing, because mainly because of the blood from the three basic species which have gone into it in different proportions. So you have to search for the characters. And besides that, this use of the common name of lime, orange, mandarin, lemon across all these types has definitely created a lot of confusion. This collection was for conservation, I would say, is a very important step which was undertaken by the botanic NBPGR, Dr. S.K. Malik, and a member of his team, O.P. Dhariwal. These two have focused on collection of citrus in the northeastern region. State by state, we have collected the material. This detail is available in the 2012 reference that I have given of Dr. S.K. Malik et al. The important thing is that they have listed the areas in India where you have field gene banks of citrus. If any farmer, anybody is interested in getting his problem sorted out, he has come across a new disease, he has a unique type, he wants to know how he can ensure that it is perpetuated, he can get advice. Just have a look at that book. It is available online. There is no problem about accessing it. The very important thing is that we had in the NBPGR that we have this cryopreservation facility in which you store not only below zero, but you also store it in liquid nitrogen. Liquid nitrogen is an important thing for storing embryos. Seeds can be stored below zero, but for embryos and tissues, you need to have liquid nitrogen, and you store it in the atmosphere of the nitrogen. Dr. Rekha Chaudhary is the one who had started the cryopreservation facility. Dr. J. Radhamani is the one who worked out this intermediate status, how to work with the seeds and ensure that they are stored in the gene bank. We have had cytogenetic and molecular work being taken up by some of the students who have worked with Dr. Malik. And Dr. K. N. Nair has had a project on Citrus indica, and he has done the molecular work on that. There are very few wild species which have been studied in so much detail. That is one plus point that I have to say for this species, though there are others which need detailed studies, like Citrus latipus, which is the Khasi papeda, You have Megaloxycarpa, which is from the Indonesian region, Ichangensis, which is from the Chinese region and a frost-resistant material. K.N. Nair, I just have to indicate, he's a very senior scientist in the National Botanical Research Institute at Lucknow. I hope...
So, I have a couple of questions, Mrs. Nair. Yeah. So we find these things in South India. We find Coorg oranges, right, yeah. in Coorg, for example. Yeah. Then we find bitter oranges. And again, yes. they come in various size. Sometimes we see bitter oranges, which are smaller. And sometimes, like yesterday, we got these bitter oranges, which were like really big, almost the size of pomelos, right? These are what? These are finally, these are basically citrus indica and its various...
Citrus indica. Citrus indica is a wild species which you get in the Nokrek Biosphere Reserve. This okay. is the material which has been developed as hybrids, mostly between pomelo and the mandarin type.
Okay.
And as I said, the hybrids, when the hybrids hybridize with other species, you get multiple hybrids coming up as we've got with the orange. What happens is that the amount of variation is different and therefore adaptation to different conditions also differs. Mm-hmm. That is the reason why in the Nagpur orange is different from the Coorg orange. It is different from the orange which you are getting the eastern plains towards the north.
Okay.
You have that the area of cultivation of orange is huge, but the different places you have different. So much so that Jalna orange has been given a separate GI from the Nagpur orange.
Okay. And sweet lime, where does sweet lime come from? Mosambi?
Mosambi is another hybrid, which is with citra.
Okay.
Of mandarin.
Okay. Okay.
Which is the reason you are having, like citron, it has a milder flavor.
Mm-hmm.
But it is because it has that mandarin component into it, it has a juicy interior. Unlike right. citra.
Right, right, right. And then in eastern India, we have some of these limes like Gandharaj lime, right? In West Bengal and then in some parts of Bihar as well, right?
Yeah.
So that has like this awesome smell.
Absolutely. Oh, it's a beautiful smell and it's such a mild one. That yeah. is one thing I discovered when I was doing my work. I found that the loose-skinned orange that we have, the Nagpur one, for example, is not a good one for making into made into candy because it becomes bitter. Melon that you see, lemon that you see, you try to make it into a candy. It's fantastic. The aroma and the texture, everything makes it a beautiful candy.
Got it. So, do you have any tips? For example, so we miss all of these lemons in Bangalore, right? So easy to find in West Bengal, you just go to the bazaar and you find it. So if you want to grow some of these lemons in our backyard or in pots, do you have any tips or suggestions on what might work or is it a futile effort?
I wouldn't call it a futile effort. Let me just talk, since you talk about the Bengal lemon and that's what I'm also very interested in. The plants have come up in Delhi in our friend's house.
Okay.
But it hasn't fruited.
Mm-hmm.
It is niche specific as far as its flowering and fruiting, especially its setting the fruits are concerned. Even though flowering had happened once, I heard, but the fruit set has not been there. Bengal, the climate is so different. And think of it, it is the eastern plains. So it's just below the area where you have maximum diversity. And that is quite suitable for the growing of the unique types there. It may not do as well here, but I think it could do well if you were in, for example, one of the hill stations in the south.
Mm-hmm.
You may be, you know, where it is more equitable weather, you may be able to. In Bangalore, probably it will be more difficult. It is it's slightly lower. A little higher, if you could go and do it, you may succeed there. Citrus is very adaptable. And I think the number of successes are more than the number of failures when you want to grow a new type in a particular area.
So I have a question about that. So generally, like we find that when you move plants from one region to another, like they may not perform as expected. Like for example, I think especially with chilies, like yeah. if you bring it to if you bring it out of its native climate, like it might not actually be as spicy or whatever.
Yeah.
But you said that lemons are like the citrus are basically very adaptable. So what is it about like citrus that actually makes it so adaptable, and how are there so many different varieties of citrus that are
okay there? Let me just start out by saying this thing. For example, citron, it is a self-pollinated crop. When a crop is self-pollinated by a single tree can give you the seeds, it has less variability inherent in the species. But that species is not only available in the Indian region, it's there in the Indonesian region. Think of it, it's so different from the Indian northeastern region. You have it in the southern Chinese region and even going further towards the Sino-Japanese region. So you're having a wide area, stands to reason you are having, in terms of adaptation to different habitat conditions, you're having a lot of diversity. So if you have a hybrid which has been formed in South China, which you want to bring into the peninsula region, for example, you may not succeed with that. But if you brought the same hybrid from the Indonesian region, where the blood has come from a different variant of citron, you may be successful, which is the reason in general in plant genetic resources, when you're starting out with trying to adapt the material to a new area, you start out with a good parent population, which is quite diverse. So that you give it scope to and understand which is likely to adapt to the new condition. That is plus point. But when you said this, there's one more point which you have to be very careful of. Taking material from one area to the other, this field gene bank concept, in fact, is what has led to so many of the global diseases that have become devastating. When you take material out of one area, unfortunately, we do not have a good quarantine within the country. But you should be aware of this, that when you are bringing material, you should ensure that the material is as far as possible free of diseases and pests. And when I'm talking of diseases and pests, they may not be obvious. Viruses may not be obvious. They may be just part of the plant material. They don't come up at that area from where you've collected it. It's a very good idea to ensure that there aren't any inherent diseases and pests associated with the material which you transfer from one part to the other, especially in horticultural crops.
So, like, there are farmers like who are trying to grow newer and newer crops. So if they do want to try out a different crop, like what would you suggest like they do basically to ensure like quarantine or how does it work?
Since we are talking about citrus, the most important thing is that the wild species and some of those which can be commercially used for juices or edible purposes, like the Rangpur lime, Khasi papeda, these are the things which are used as rootstocks. They are generally hardy material. And they have been doing well. For example, quite a number of them are available in the northwestern parts of the country also now. These are some of the materials which the farmers can afford to try in the area and keep a very good vigilance on that material which you're growing, to ensure that it is doing well and is healthy. If there is any problem, immediately contact an expert, try to get their opinion to see what is going wrong.
Right. For example, I know a farmer who's growing Rangpur lime pretty accidentally. I mean, he essentially identified it later. Once it started fruiting, he realized it's Rangpur lime. And it's growing in Sakleshpur. And he has a bunch of trees there, and he basically markets the concentrate out of that. So like lime cordial, etc. I mean, basically he makes Rangpur lime concentrate and he sells that, and it's actually pretty good. It has a nice, it tastes better than regular lime concentrate, you know.
This is a beautiful piece of lovely item that you've mentioned. When such a thing has been successfully done, I would suggest that a small write-up is prepared and sent to a thing like an Indian Farming. It's a very popular magazine, and it comes to the notice of a large number of scientific and non-scientific community.
Okay.
You should put it up. I mean, this is a success story. And remember one thing, farmers who are successful in doing such things are given awards. We have this Plant Variety Protection Authority with headquarters in Delhi. Every year, they give awards to farmers who have made successful introductions of materials, brought in new crops, even developed new crops, and they're given certificates for them and they are valued. Please don't miss out this opportunity. You must ensure that it is.
I'll definitely tell Marvin about that. I don't think he is aware that he has done a breakthrough. So I'll tell him about that.
Yeah.
So the other question is about like kumquat, because of its form factor, etc. To me, it seems that kumquat is something which for terrace gardeners, etc. would be very interesting, right? Because even in a small pot, if you are able to get a harvest, you'll get a lot of fruits essentially, right? But where is kumquat originally from and where does it grow really well?
Kumquat is mostly from, you can say, beyond the Indo-Chinese region to Philippines. That is the area where kumquat is really good. Which is the reason to find kumquat is growing well in Australia, for example, that part of it. So I think we should be successful. At least some of the material can come up here. Because Fortunella is, it has always been thought of as a pretty hardy material, very easy to adapt material. I think it should be able to come up in pots.
Okay.
Yeah, getting the material may be a problem at the beginning, but otherwise I think it should be possible.
Got it.
You mentioned this disease that is affecting citrus. So can you just like elaborate a bit on that and sort of compare it? Like, I think we all know it's hit mainstream news that bananas are dying across the world. Yeah. And but I don't think you people know much about this citrus. So what exactly is it and what is going on?
So it is a citrus. What it does is it causes greening of the plant, of the tissue. They call it greening, basically because the flower drop is high, the fruit set is affected, ultimately the plant dies. The insects, as I showed that photograph, insect is on a pinhead. It's that small. It's something like you've seen the aphids which come up. One, and you have a large number coming up on a plant. Therefore, controlling it, especially when you have a large number in the nodes, it's a big problem. And that is the reason they are being very cautious, in the sense as soon as they become aware of it, they're trying to control it. But because of the size of the insect, that's a vector, and because of the variation so far that has been recorded at least, you find that the heat tolerant, the heat sensitive, that takes care of a wide range of conditions in which it can affect. I came across a report which had been presented in one of the seminars in Peninsula India. They have said that in their orchards, they are getting citrus greening disease. And therefore, they said some of the orchards have become unproductive. This is a real problem in quite a number of the horticultural plants. We talk of banana because it's become a global phenomenon. But the same is true, especially that we are talking about citrus, and therefore that Vidarbha region, the Maharashtra region is very important. Pomegranate, the same problem has happened. You have a lot of cultivation, it has become a cash crop, and then it gets affected to such in such a devastating manner. It's very difficult. We have to control it. And citrus greening, so far the control has been quite difficult.
Speaking of this Vidarbha region, can you like, so how it's, what is the story of the Nagpur orange? I mean, it's called Nagpur orange, but why is it called Nagpur orange, especially when it's not something that's native to India? So what is the story and how did it get here?
See, the oranges have been very successful in the northeastern India and eastern India. It has always been successful because from the Chinese to the Indian region, India to China, India to Indochina, Indochina to the Indian region, things have been successful. That is, that whole area is a center of diversity of citrus. And therefore, it has been successful there. The records say that the Bhosles were the rulers and Nagpur was the headquarters of the Vidarbha region where they were ruling. And they specifically got this material, which was doing very well in the Eastern Plains, and brought it to their area. And that point that I had mentioned, which is recorded, I found in the Riverside Chronicles, where they say that the farmers have definitely made a point of trying to ensure that they've got those conditions of extreme heat stress and waiting for the monsoons. And if the monsoons did not come, then you give the irrigation. But whatever it is, you have that uniform flowering. And I would have thought it was an understood factor that it has been mentioned, and a reference of Gandhi has been given where he has talked about this method that has been done. So I think in that area, it has probably been developed. See, it is written in 1956.
Right.
The reference that resting treatment is something they seem to have developed for that area.
Hmm.
Important thing, if you see, I saw the orchards that you have going from Nagpur up to Akola. That undulating area, more or less rocky feel to that area, it is a typical place where you can bring in a lot of heat stress. Heat stress would be there even in the sandy soils of Rajasthan or even the Delhi areas. But that soil and that rocky soil, that gravelly soil, and that undulating terrain, which means water doesn't stand, I think that is a unique condition why that Nagpur orange has been successful in that area.
Right.
I have a slightly separate question. Let's say I'm a farmer and I'm growing oranges, and I want my oranges to be very sweet. Is there anything that I could do to help it become sweeter? Like in terms of, I don't know, perhaps inducing some stress or pruning or any other techniques that I can use to make my fruit a little sweeter?
I think they're already doing it, because you do that pruning in the Nagpur oranges is quite an important factor, I'm told. And the second point is that the Nagpur orange is famous for its sweetness already. What you would be wanting in an orange would not be more sweetness. What you would be wanting probably would be a little more aroma, as we were talking about that Bengal lemon. You know, it has a different nuance and aroma that you're having, and therefore the taste is affected, its use is affected. Think of it when you're having some of these jams, for example, which are made. The seven orange is giving you a very good jam, which is totally different from what you get from the Nagpur orange or any of our oranges here. There is a tinge of bitterness has to be there. So you cannot talk of it's not just in terms of sweetness. It is a combination of the bitterness versus a sweetness, so that it becomes acceptable. Sweetness itself can become too bland also, in a way. You know, right. Bland to the palate, because it's too sweet.
Right.
Need to have that balance of the bitterness and sweetness to have a very acceptable type. That perfection which you have from the Nagpur oranges, probably you have to think of it as having been developed. If we lose that flavor, then you will have to think of bringing in some hybrid, doing some hybridization. But think of it, quinoa. So there's been so much of improvement in the flavor, the texture, and other features of the fruit.
Right.
Citrus, you want to do it, you can do it. Citrus is the crop for it.
I actually always find it very interesting that, I find quinoa more sweeter than the Nagpur orange, for example, right? But it's more, Nagpur orange is still more popular. I mean, if you get somebody in Bangalore and give him a quinoa and ask him to taste a Nagpur orange, although the quinoa will be sweeter, but he'll probably prefer overall the Nagpur orange fruit. So that I always find quite interesting. There's another variety that we have seen, especially we see it a lot in US markets, but in India also, there are some farmers who have just started doing it. These are those baby mandarins. So they'll be mandarins, but they'll be really tiny, small in size. And you will get so many of them in 1 kilo. And because they look so good on supermarket shelves, so they move out pretty fast, right? Yeah. Now, are these essentially mandarins kind of you know, by doing selection across generations and slowly getting their size reduced, and maybe I don't remember whether they have seeds, or are these mandarins crossed with something else?
In citrus, the selection over generations is not a not an important aspect. Okay. It's a that have been made in between the suitable parental types that has given you the successful one.
Okay.
For a larger fruit, you will be able to find coming from citron or from what you are the Medica.
Hmm.
Point becomes that a smaller fruit, you would be going for a species with smaller fruit and use it as a, for the hybridization program rather than selecting for the smaller fruits over time. Most important that, there that point is what I talked about, polyembryony in citrus. Except for these two species, most of the other materials are polyembryonic, which means that you cross, you won't be able to get the true seeds. Putting a hybrid seed from which you can raise the new plant and select it out. It's only when you are able to make a successful cross, backcross it, or select from it that you'll be able to improve over generations. Citrus doesn't give you that option.
Got it. Got it.
That is a very important and a very unique point about citrus.
So let us open up to questions from others as well. If anybody else has any questions, Surabhi, you had raised your hand once. If you have a question, please feel free. Anybody else? Do you have a question?
So just while we wait, if anyone has any questions, please raise your hand and we'll take your question. So while we wait, here's a question that a lot of people might want to know, especially home gardeners. So if you want to grow your like citrus at home, can you just take the seeds from, you know, these cool varieties, let's say that you find on Farmizen, and can you just plant them in your backyard, or do you have to go looking for saplings, and is it even feasible to grow in a pot or maybe in your small garden?
Yes, you would be able to, you can by and large grow most of the citrus in a pot, and if you can grow them in the soil, especially the tree types, you'll be successful. It has, the seeds in general have a life of about a fortnight. But there are a few which will not survive more than a week. That is what Dr. Rekha Chaudhary specifically told me. We have done, as I said, Northeastern region, Dr. Malik's collections, they run into hundreds, which they have been able to store and cryopreserve.
Okay.
Therefore, yes, the answer to that is it is by and large possible.
So it, just plant the seeds in the soil and we're good to go.
There was a study I saw somewhere, I wouldn't even call it a study, it was just an amateur who had done it. He removed the seed coat and he planted it. He put it with the seed coat and he looked at the difference and he found that without the seed coat, it did not make a difference. A major significant difference in the establishment of the new seedlings in pots.
Okay. Anyone has any questions, let us know. Otherwise, we will end the session. So
there is just one point I would like to make. I forgot to do it, especially when we talked about that Rangpur line. You know, quite a number of the farmers may have some of the types, either those which they've inherited from their fathers, grandfathers, etc. Maybe just one or two trees. Please ensure that those are maintained because they are likely to be important. I came across some of the material they have indicated as being grown in the 18th century in Andhra Pradesh. There's no other record available in any Indian literature or any other literature of that material. And it is supposed to be an important land race which used to be grown over quite a large tract of the semi-arid regions in Andhra Pradesh. So we have lost a lot of material. We can ensure that we don't lose some of the other land races that we have.
So here's the one that I was talking about, bitter orange. Yeah. You can see. If I can show it.
Just the farmers having it with him?
Yeah. just a second.
Shamik, it's sort of...
I'm just going to...
Blending into your vacation.
I know. I need to change my background once. One second. Just give me a minute. Yeah, yeah. So this is those huge bitter orange. It has a very strong taste. And again, like you can make really good marmalade out of it, for example, right? So I'm gonna open this up. So see, oh my God.
Did you get only the fruit or do you have the plant also accessible?
The plant is accessible. I don't have it here, of course. This is also from Coorg, if you can see. So the color is also slightly different.
Yeah.
It actually has a bitterish taste, but people who like marmalades and stuff like that, it's pretty cool. It's very strong. The taste is very strong. So right now, for example, at Parmesan, we have pomelos, we have sweet lime. So it was very interesting to see all the stuff that you're mentioning. Because I never had an idea that pomelos were from outside India, because it's just so common here. Like just 100 meters, 200 meters away, there's a pomelo tree and nobody really cares because it's very common and it's just hanging there on the roadside, right? So pomelos are extremely common. Grapefruit, something that we have realized, it's one of my personal favorite citruses. I really like grapefruit, but at least in South India, the demand seems to be less. You know, I think it's a fruit which has a which is very good. It has a lot of health benefits, etc. It tastes excellent as well. But the demand in South India seems to be less. The other interesting thing was you mentioned Abohar about quinoas, right? So I didn't know that Abohar was the origin, because a lot of our partner farmers who send us quinoas, etc. are from Abohar. People who send us, you know, Malta, for example, right? So I was wondering, what is it about Abohar? And I was thinking, that, oh, it's maybe just, but there seems to be a history behind that. That there
is a very old citrus station.
Right. So very.
But this material that you have, I identified if I can have the material. Why not know the true identity of it?
Ha, 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 ha.
If you have a plant twig where you can see the leaves, you can see the about at least, it should be 1 foot long.
Okay.
If you can dry the plant.
Okay.
And send it across.
Okay. Okay.
It can be identified. And it can be.
Even in citron, I mean, in Bangalore, in all of the farms nearby, the citrons I see are more or less this size small. But then there's one partner farmer, she grows it near Bandipur. Like it's a jungle, and near Bandipur, she grows it, and her citrons are like each one is 1 kg, huge ones, and elongated, strange shaped, you know.
How old is her farm? I mean, how long has she been farming there?
She has been doing homesteading there for about 5-6 years.
Okay. It may be that long term, that soil has made a difference. I mean, it is not something which has been farmed for a very long time. That could make a difference in the beginning.
Okay. Got it.
That could be one reason.
Got it. Also about pomelos, like it's not something that's very popular in North India, I believe, right? We don't see it much.
They are popular, all right. Okay, in the north it is definitely more popular. That I would agree. But you find that you have it all over, in all the states you have it. I mean, in more areas completely missing it.
Okay.
Very sad. extremely strong taste.
And what about the seeds?
The seeds actually. I mean, this is how the seeds look.
Okay.
No, it's bigger than orange seeds.
And a little flatter.
Pardon?
Little flatter, I guess.
Yeah. It's definitely...
Prashant, is this recorded, Prashant?
Yes.
Then if you can let me have this fruit, I will send it to Dr. Malik and let him look at it.
Okay.
Sure.
Cool. Yeah. So thank you so much, Dr. Nair. If anybody, last call, if anybody has any questions, otherwise we'll call it a day. Joseph, did you have any questions? Hi, Joseph. You just unmuted yourself, but we are not able to hear you. Okay. Okay, cool. Thank you so much. I had no clue about the history of, I mean, the one fruit that I'm really keen on getting my hands on is that Buddha's hand. It just looks so beautiful, right? It looks amazing. So I hope it also tastes amazing as well, right? But this is something, I mean, I have to get hold of this. I mean, I've been looking for it. I don't know whether it grows anywhere in India at all. Maybe somewhere in North
India. It is there in India also.
Okay. Okay. Yeah. Okay. I've never seen this in the market. So
it's not that popular because you would be finding, if you go to, try to go to a Chinese market, like if you went to Calcutta, probably.
Right.
Especially in March, that's when the Chinese New Year is there, no?
Right. Very interesting. So thank you so much, Dr. Nair. It was a pleasure having you here. And I hope you enjoyed our questions, etc. as well. And we'll get in touch with you with some of these interesting things which sometimes the farmers also don't know. You know, they have two trees in their backyard and they don't really know the history of it. And it produces some interesting fruit. So I think it's good to know that we can, we can take it to these magazines and stuff like that. So very cool. Thank you so much. Take care, guys, everybody.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye.